I'm standing here today in Grand Teton National Park in Wyoming in the good old US of A. And I want to talk to you today about a word the Lord spoke to me this morning from Psalm chapter 23. Psalm chapter 23, you know, that is the one psalm that people know usually for things like funerals and comfort. But I want to talk to you about this psalm prophetically today because I believe it reflects exactly what the Lord is doing in the body of Christ. Psalm chapter 23. It starts out by saying this, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." I want to tell you today that whatever need you have, whatever thing, usually the needs are financial, but it could also mean comfort or encouragement or anything else like that. Maybe you need a new job or that kind of provision. But I want you to know that the Bible absolutely promises you, God Himself promises you, that you will not be in want. In other words, you shall not be in lack. The word want there doesn't mean that you won't desire anything. It means you're not going to lack. And I can tell you through the course of my life and also my ministry that even though sometimes I don't know where provision is going to come from, sometimes I don't know how God is going to help, but He always helps. The Lord really is your shepherd, and you will not lack for anything when you make Jesus Christ your Savior. I also want to say, though, the next verse goes on. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures." You know, friend, sometimes we underestimate that word make. We don't love to lie down in green pastures. We don't love to take a break, take a load off, sit down and trust God. The Lord has really been dealing with me about this today because He spoke to me that this chapter is our inheritance for this time and this season. And you know what? Immediately something in my spirit rose up and pushed back like, "Noah, I don't want that, God. That's not the inheritance I want. I don't want you to make me lie down. I don't want you to make me stop and smell the roses, if you will." But you know what? God has better plans for us than we could possibly conjure up for ourselves. And when the Lord says, "Lie down in these green pastures," when He actually makes us to lie down in these green pastures, even though we don't want to, sometimes when we refuse, when we say, "No, God, I prefer to strive and drive," which has been my habit my whole life. I've really struggled with rest my whole life. Well, sometimes He takes away that grace for striving and driving in order to help make us lie down. Sometimes He sits down with us and says, "Okay, come here and sit on my lap." Imagine how you would treat a little baby sheep. Because remember, this whole psalm shows us the Lord as our proverbial shepherd. Okay? And it's not just proverbial. He really is our shepherd. But what would you do if you had a little cute baby lamb and you needed that lamb to lie down and rest? Would you sit down and let that lamb come and nuzzle you and snuggle you? And would you pick him up and hold him and help him to rest? Yes. That's what the Lord does for us. Sometimes we need a little help. Sometimes we need the Lord to minister to us, to even help us stop and rest. But the word does say that He makes us to lie down. That means sometimes, my friend, He forces the issue. So He makes me lie down. Where? In green pastures. That means He finds the best places for us to rest. He provides for you to go on the best weekend away. He provides for you to have the most peaceful day at home. He provides for you to have the most refreshing dinner out by yourself or with your family or with your friends. He makes us lie down in green pastures. When He forces us, when He forces the issue, He never forces our will, but He will arrange the circumstances in such a way that we find ourselves backed into a corner sometimes by His goodness. But you know what? There's no place that is better for you to be than backed into a corner by the goodness of God. But He makes us lie down, but they are in green pastures. And that is a refreshing word that I hope you will take unto yourself. When the Lord takes away His grace for driving and striving, and He makes you lie down, He doesn't make you lie down in a barren place. He doesn't make you lie down in the wilderness. No, He knows that it's hard enough for you to stop. It's hard enough for you to rest. So you know what? He gives you the best of places to rest in. He gives you the most verdant of green pastures. He gives you the green pastures with the most beautiful flowers. He gives you the green pastures with the best provision. He makes you lie down in green pastures because He never puts too much on you. He never will give you something that He won't help you through. So He makes you lie down in green pastures. Now, the next part of this chapter says He leads you beside still waters. I was meditating on that this morning, again, somewhat in a hesitant way because I wasn't sure if this was a good thing or a bad thing that the Lord was telling me, Psalm 23, this is what's happening to you right now and to the body of Christ. But he leads you beside still waters. You know what I believe that means? I believe the Lord right now is saying, come and get still with me. I'm going to show you what the next season of your life looks like. Come and get still with me. I'm going to give you wisdom for what to do next, where to go next. And there is something about still waters. Why? Because the water is representative of Jesus. It's representative of the Holy Spirit. Remember, Jesus said, out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. When we see these things in nature, remember, God created the natural world to be the very first preacher. The Apostle Paul told us that men are altogether without excuse because the heavens and the earth, the natural world of the creation, all proclaim the glory and the goodness of God. So we have all seen God. We've all seen his nature out in the created world. Well, when we sit down in those green pastures and then the Lord leads us beside the still waters, I believe there is literally something about being out in nature, being out with the still waters, being in a place of stillness and rest where God can unfold his vision. The Lord did this for me one day several years ago. When I started this ministry in 2012, I felt like I was supposed to get away and just spend some time hearing vision from the Lord in nature. And so I was blessed to be able to take one night and one morning in Cades Cove of the Great Smoky Mountain National Park here in our Appalachian Mountains in the USA. And in that one night, in that one morning, I only had a few hours alone, but the Lord downloaded to me his entire vision that he would let me see, that he would allow me to see at that time anyway, for this ministry. And I was just wrecked. I was laying on the floor of my tent, face down before God, just writing and scribing what the Lord was saying. And he led me in that place. You know what? Today, I believe he's doing the same thing for you, that he's leading you beside still waters, that wherever you are right now, if you can just get away into a still place, into a quiet place where you can hear, because the things that God wants to speak to you today are so sacred that any amount of stress and background noise tends to prevent you from hearing. But you do hear the Lord, and God will speak to you right now beside the still waters. So I encourage you to find a place that is peaceful and restful and allow God to download his vision into you. I believe this is what he's doing in this time. Now, going back to Psalm 23, where it says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. What does it say next? It says, he restores my soul. My friend, so many of us right now are in a place where our souls need restoring. Do you feel dry? Do you feel empty? Do you feel half-baked, half-done, worn to a frazzle? That means your soul needs to be restored. It means your mind, your will, and your emotions need to be refilled, and the Lord is the only one who can do that. So right now, if you feel like you've got nothing left, if you're just running on fumes, running on adrenaline, running on sheer willpower, I want to encourage you to take some time and let the Lord restore your soul. I know this is hard, especially if you feel as I do so often, like you have to work, you have to produce, you have to perform in order to make basic ends meet, in order to get things done. But you know what? Here's something that I hope will encourage you today. Every single time that I have ever stopped to rest, to let the Lord restore my soul when I was in dire need of rest, every single time I have been shaking in my boots about whether or not everything would be okay in my absence. But you know what? Every time, the Lord has miraculously provided in ways that I could never have anticipated, have never seen before, and have never seen since, except for in those times when again I've taken a period of rest. It's been crazy. The Lord will do that for you today as well. The Lord will restore your soul if you'll let him. And while you let him minister to you, while you check yourself into the Lord's hospital, if you will, where Holy Ghost just restores you and refills you and makes you all replenished and takes you from feeling dry to feeling well watered, he will provide for your needs. You will not see it coming. You'll not know how it's going to happen, but you'll step out on faith and say, let God be true and every man a liar, and the Lord will provide for you supernaturally. You have to be willing to let him. You have to be brave enough and bold enough to step out on faith. And I will tell you, for me at least, it is hard. I'm not going to lie to you and say, oh, it's so easy. No, I mean, you have to really stamp that dead flesh down and say, I am going to obey God, even if all of the thoughts in my head are all confused and don't have a clue how it's going to happen. You say, I'm going to obey God and let him restore my soul. But God will do that for you. Jesus wants to restore your soul today. He wants to heal you and refresh you. He wants to give you a renewed outlook on life. He wants to give you your song back. He wants to help you sing again. He wants that joy to bubble up out of your gut again. Okay, to put that smile back on your face and that dance back in your step. And he wants you to have that river of creativity again that you used to have. The Lord knows that those creative things that you love to do, that you just haven't felt like doing for so long, you need rest in order to get that back. Those gifts are not gone. Those talents are not gone. The gifts and the call of God are irrevocable and without repentance, the Bible says. But you know what? In order to flow in that river, you can't be a dried out, burned out mess. In order to flow in that river, you have got to let the Lord flow through you and be well watered. That's where creativity comes from. It comes from being rested. So friend, I want to encourage you to let the Lord do that for you today. Now, the next part of this chapter, again, starting at the beginning, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. I want you to know, number one, that the Lord has placed his name upon you. You know how very often in many cultures, when a man and a woman get married, the woman changes her last name to match the man's last name? Why? Because it shows that they are together. They are one now. You know what? The Lord has given you his name. Why? Because you are the bride of Christ. It doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman. You are the bride of Christ. You are who he died for. And he has attached his name to you. And he leads you beside still waters. He restores your soul and he leads you in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. It's because he loves you and it's because he's in covenant with you that he will lead you. Psalm 32:8 says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will guide you with my eye upon you. And then the Lord encourages you, don't be like the horse or the mule, which lack understanding and have to have their mouths held firm with bit and bridle or else they will not come with you. But the Lord says to go easily with him and he will lead you. He will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. That's what it means when he says he leads you in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. It's because you belong to him. God cares about everything that concerns you, and he cares about you so much more even than you care about yourself. God will perfect all things that concern you if you'll let him lead you and if you'll follow him. So he leads you in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And then this was one of my favorite passages, or this was one of my favorite parts of this verse as the Lord was speaking to me this morning. It says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. My friend, you may feel like you're in a valley right now, and you may feel like it has the shadow of death. But you know what? Shadows are not real. Shadows are not the real thing. Shadows are only something that portrays the image of the real thing. But the real thing is not actually there if you touch a shadow. The attack of the enemy right now is meant to discourage you and to shake you away from your faith, because whatever is not of faith is sin. If the enemy can get you to step out of faith into your flesh, into your own understanding, into fear, into doubt, into unbelief, and any of those things that are not pleasing to the Lord, then he's got you. Then he can open a door into your life and he can wreak havoc. But you know what? You don't have to go there. This morning, the enemy was tempting me with all kinds of things, negative thoughts, and I said no in the name of Jesus. I didn't want to say no, honestly. My flesh wanted to just go right down that nasty, dark slide. But my spirit rose up and said, God, I will obey you. And so I began to speak the word over the situation. I began to pray. I began to pray in the spirit. And you know what? All of a sudden, I set a timer on this too. It didn't take very long. It took 5 minutes. And I felt so much better. And the attack of the enemy that he had launched against me, those darts that he launches against me or against you, they were gone. Well, you know what? You can stand in faith like that too. I know it's hard. I know sometimes we just want to get all in our flesh and just go down and get into self-pity, get into negative thoughts, get into saying, oh, it's over, you know, and just proclaim death. But it is only a shadow of death. There is no actual death in it unless you accept it as such. Okay, so you've got to walk through. That's the promise of the Lord, that you can walk through that valley. There is another side for you. The other side is not a valley at all, but the other side is a place of brightness. The other side is a place of light, and you are going through. Your problems have a shelf life, my friend. Those problems are going to be over, and you are going to enter a new season. The Lord is going to set you into a broad place, a wide place with a good inheritance. That's what will happen for you if you will just persevere. Walk on through that valley. And when you're tired of walking, my friend, I know it can be hard, but just walk on. Pick yourself up by your bootstraps and walk through that valley, because there is an inheritance on the other side for you. You know what that inheritance is? The Bible says, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." Let me talk about that real quick. The rod and the staff were the shepherd's tools, and the shepherd used these tools to guide the sheep. The shepherd didn't beat the sheep with the rod or the staff, but he guided them gently. He pulled them away from dangerous things and kept them going the right direction. And that's how the Lord is leading you today, right now. His rod and his staff are comforting you, leading you, and guiding you. But then, you know, the Lord says in Psalm 23 that he prepares a table before you in the presence of your enemies. I want to encourage you in this way. The Bible doesn't say he prepares a table before you without your enemies. No. The enemies are actually necessary in order for you to receive the table that is prepared for you. God prepares a table before you in the presence of your enemies. So when you're looking at, oh, how are things going to work out? When you're looking at, is this the shadow of death or is this real death? When you're looking at questions like, what on earth am I going to do tomorrow? How am I going to make it happen? I want you to know that he prepares a table before you in the presence of your enemies. Those temptations, those questions of doubt and unbelief, the leaning on your own understanding, these things can be your enemies, and they are your enemies. For the Lord says, don't lean on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. You know what? He prepares that table before you, and his table is huge and broad and filled with every good thing, but it is in the presence of your enemy. You have to actually take the stand to sit at the table and dine at the banquet of God in the presence of your enemies. That can be hard because your enemies don't want you to do that. Your enemies don't want you to rest. Your enemies don't want you to be blessed. Your enemies want to destroy your life if possible, as Jesus told us in John 10 and verse 10, that the thief does not come except to steal, kill, and destroy. But then Jesus said, but I am come that you may have life and that you may have it abundantly to the full until it overflows, as it says in the Amplified Classic Version. My friend, there is a table that is being prepared for you by God himself in the presence of your enemies. And then it says, he anoints my head with oil, my cup runs over. The oil is the oil of the Holy Spirit. Shepherds take oil and put it on the head of their sheep. But you know what? The Lord anoints you with oil even more than that. The Lord puts the oil inside your belly to where out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. The thing the Lord is bringing you into is a wide place, a broad place, and a good place where you will have joy again, joy unspeakable and full of glory. You will have the joy that you've been craving. You will not feel dry and worn out anymore, but you will be well watered, and you will be anointed, and you'll be able to revel in delight in the anointing that wards off the heat of the desert and the heat of the day and the heat of the enemy's attacks. Remember, it is the anointing that breaks the yoke, and it is the oil of joy that the Lord pours on you. So he prepares a table before you in the presence of your enemies. He anoints your head with oil, and then your cup runs over. That means when you get to that side, through the valley of the shadow of death, through those decisions to rest or not rest, and you're going to choose to rest. When you get to that other side, you are in a place where you say, it's as if I woke up from a dream. As it says in the Psalms, when the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, we were like those who dream. You'll be like, am I in a dream? Is it too good to be true? But it's not going to be too good to be true. It's going to be true for you because you chose to walk in the ways of the Lord. So then finally, this passage says, Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. My friend, your place is in the house of the Lord, and this is a guarantee that surely God's goodness and mercy will follow you. You have that guarantee. Surely. It is not a question. It is not a doubt. It's not up for discussion, but surely the goodness of the Lord. That means God will provide for you, because Psalm 68 tells us that he provides from his goodness for the poor. It means his goodness and his mercy. God's mercy covers all of those things that you can't cover in your human flesh. And a lot of things that we try to cover ourselves, really, we'd be better off if we just let the Lord do them. So surely goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life. The rest of your days are going to be better than the former days. God's mercy and his goodness will always be with you. And they're with you right now, all the days of your life. And then you will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. My friend, according to Revelation, it is your portion for you to be a pillar in the house of the Lord. It is not your portion to go in and go out and be cast out of the presence of the Lord, but always to stay in. That is what the Lord says in Revelation chapters 1-3. And I want that to be the word of the Lord to you today. And that is what the Lord is speaking to you today, that you will be covered surely with his goodness and mercy, and you will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. My friend, it's a good inheritance the Lord is giving you. And I pray that today you'll take the steps necessary to receive it, to walk in the ways of the Lord, to rest and let him restore your soul, to hear his vision in the quiet and the stillness, to reject all the attacks of the enemy and the temptations of the enemy that say, oh no, this is death. No, you say, I speak life. I'm going to walk through this valley because it's only a shadow. I won't be afraid. And then you're going to get to eat that table in the presence of your enemies, and you are going to be covered with the goodness and mercy of God all the days of your life. Even now you're still covered, but you're going to eat of the goodness of God, of the banquet of God, and you will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Thanks so much for tuning in today.